Good morning and welcome to this online service for Grace Church Leatherhead. My name is Richard Plumbridge and I'll be introducing and leading the service this morning, and I wish you a very warm welcome, whether you're a regular of our attendees or members, or whether you've just stumbled across us on the internet, or whether you've looked for us and you've found us and this is your first visit. You are most welcome, and I pray that you will be blessed by what you see and hear this morning as we come before our Lord and God and worship him for all he is and all he has done for us. Our pastor, Jon Herring, will be continuing his series on the unstoppable gospel from the book of Acts. A little later in the service, so please have your Bibles ready. I'm going to read a few verses from Psalm 98 and then I'm going to pray. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvellous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made known his salvation, he has revealed his righteousness in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his steadfast love and faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Please would you join with me as I now pray. Our gracious Lord God and Heavenly Father, you have made your salvation known to all the nations of the earth through our Lord Jesus Christ, and we give you thanks and praise for this glorious gift that you have given us in Christ Jesus our Lord. We thank you that you are the sovereign Lord God. Not a sparrow falls to the ground without your knowledge, and every hair on each of our heads is numbered by you. And we thank you that you are in control of this pandemic and nothing will escape your notice. And Lord, we seek your blessing now, that you would bless this time together as we remember you and praise you for all your wondrous things. For we ask these mercies in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We do have something extra this morning. We are going to have a particular focus on Christians against poverty. But before we speak about that and I tell you what's happening with that, we're going to have our first song.
Blessed be your name.
I'm sure most of you are aware that Grace Church Leatherhead are a member of the Mole Valley Debt Centre for Christians Against Poverty, or CAP. The Debt Centre in Mole Valley has been running for well over 5 years now. Some of you will remember Edwin Pelly, the first Debt Centre manager. We then had Fran Pyatt, and now we've got a new Debt Centre manager, Jenny Coles. So what we've got for you this morning are three short videos. The first one is from Jenny, just to introduce herself. She will be familiar to some of you because she taught at Trinity School. Secondly, we've got Paula Stringer, who is the new chief executive of the charity. She took over from Matt Barlow last year, and she's navigating the charity through these difficult times. And thirdly, we've got a client testimony, a lady called Sharon, and she will be giving us a very powerful testimony of how her life has been changed, not just by CAP, but by her relationship with the living God. You will see in the videos various appeals to support the charity with financial contributions. I'll just say, we always say that first of all, you should be giving to your church first, because without the church, CAP cannot run. So if you'd like to give to CAP, please do, but make sure you're giving to our local church first. Enjoy the videos. After them, we'll have another song. There'll be a Bible reading, a prayer, and then John's sermon. Enjoy. My first question to you is, can you just tell us within a minute a bit about your whole life, or just tell us a bit about yourself and where you are?
Hi, Richard. Yeah, I am Jenny, and I moved into Fetcham about 30 years ago with my husband and young son. Since then, we've had two more children, and they're now all grown up. We've now got three grandchildren, which I get to see, which is fabulous. And I've been a member of St. Mary's congregation ever since I moved in. We've since moved to Effingham last autumn, but I still remain a member of St. Mary's congregation.
How can we, what prayer requests would you like the people of Grace Church Leatherhead to pray for you?
Well, as you know, Richard, we really do value prayer, and we value prayer not only for you and I as we continue to see clients, but also for the team of befrienders and volunteers that support our work by making relationships with our clients. So prayers for both of those areas would be fabulous. Also prayers for CAP head office staff who are continually lobbying for those that are more vulnerable in our society to make the that are on the fringes of poverty, to make it so that social justice is there, that they are able to maintain their own budgets. And then finally, I would like people to pray for our clients who not only have the challenges of the present COVID pandemic, but they also have their debts and other issues that they are with. So those sort of three general areas would be fabulous if your members could pray for them. I would be very, very grateful.
Indeed. Thank you very much for that. And yeah, I look forward to working with you in the future as we carry on. Thank you.
No problem. Thank you.
Hey, how are you doing? We're Wren Collective. We're excited to worship with you. We're excited to celebrate the freedom that we have in Jesus. We're excited to be here on behalf of CAP. You know, we have some stories in our lives from even Steve's mom has actually worked with CAP before and been released from poverty in Jesus' name. We love the work that they do, and we're excited about the work that Jesus does, and we're going to celebrate that. He cancels our debts, he forgives our sins, and he's worth celebrating today.
Oh, this will be my day of victory. My chains are gone, now I am free indeed. Every debt is paid by amazing grace. All that's left is to celebrate. Your love has won, I'm free indeed. My jubilee has come.
Let's go!
We have a story of grace. We have an anthem of hope. We have a reason to praise. We are redeemed and restored. You are the great liberator. You ransomed us from our shame. Now by the blood of the Savior, everything broken will change. Oh, this will be my day of victory. My chains are gone, now I am free indeed. Every debt is paid by amazing grace. All that's left is to celebrate. Of the past, this is the year of the Lord. Here at the foot of the cross, we are outsiders no more. You made a way through the darkness into your marvelous light. You broke the bondage that held us. Now we are fully alive. Oh, this will be my day of victory. My chains are gone, now I am free indeed. Every debt is paid by amazing grace. All that's left is to celebrate. Your love has won, I'm free indeed. My jubilee has come. Shook the walls in my prison. You brought me back from the grave. You turned my morning to dirty. Into the night I proclaim that this will be my day of victory. My chains are gone, now I am free indeed.
Hello, I am Paula and I'm the UK Chief Executive for Christians Against Poverty. I really want to say a huge thank you to you and your church for partnering with CAP and for serving and supporting those people who are living in poverty around and in your community. Let's be honest, it's been quite a year. We will have all faced challenges in this season. There's been disruption to our daily lives, being kept away from our loved ones, and of course adapting to new ways of doing church. Now obviously we do not know currently what the longer term impacts of all of this will have on our world, but how thankful I am that God knows, and that he already has a plan mapped out. But let us not abdicate our own responsibility in this work ahead. Already we are reading of thousands of people losing their jobs in a coming recession. And also, we're still being asked to sit in our protective bubbles. Now, I've already prayed with my own church family that God will really break our hearts for what breaks his, so that we become even more driven to be his hands and feet on this earth. And that we have the courage to tell people about Jesus and share the good news that changes people right from the inside out. And I'm not sure that God would want us to just go back to the way things were. I believe he actually wants to mature us through all of this, so we see and do things differently, more as God sees them. And this is a great opportunity, isn't it, for the church to rise up and to shine even brighter. So today you are going to hear about what your church has been doing to bring hope in your area. There'll be some inspiring stories from people whose lives have been transformed thanks to your compassion and care and hard work. And I pray that as you listen, each of you will capture a vision for what you can personally do to play a part in this life-changing work. Now, some of you will already volunteer your time. Others, you'll be able to financially give. And if you don't already, I ask that you consider giving a gift today, because we can't do this without the faithful support of people just like you. And if you are already one of our wonderful life changers, which is what we call our regular givers, then thank you so much. You really are doing just like that. You are changing lives. So as we stand or sit together, trying to get through this time, I want to thank you for your resilience and your adaptability as we've adjusted really to new ways of even supporting our clients. Thank you for your commitment to changing lives in your community, and especially for your passion for sharing God's love. I really hope you enjoy your CAP celebration.
Back in the past, when I was all on my own, I mean, I thought that there's never any hope, and it's always dark. I never thought like God would ever be able to use someone like me. Even though like things that's happened to me, it still felt like God had his hand on me through the situations that I've been in. So to me, that's always been my dark side of my life. Sometimes it catches up with me, but now it seems like now I'm living in a brighter, more bigger, more colourful life. So to me, it is like night and day.
My ex-partner wouldn't let me have any money. So that's the reason why I had to take out loans, and he was taking out loans in my name as well. So yeah, it was all down to me. That's how I started to get myself in trouble. It was because I had 7 kids. That's one of the reasons back then why I couldn't do work, because I was either pregnant or they was all still little and I couldn't work. And I felt I was stupid anyway, because he used to tell me I was stupid, I was fat, I was ugly. And he used to manipulate me like that, so I was underneath his control until I used to run away for a little while, go into a hostel. And they only used to turn up outside the hostels, and the hostels couldn't have the other women in there frightened. And I had to go back to him. I had nowhere to go with the 7 kids. So, and then that's when I started to get like a private place to live in. And then, of course, as soon as I got that, that's when the letters started coming. Letitia actually answered the door to the bailiffs and they come into the house. I hid in the bedroom, on the bedroom floor, curled up in the corner while they was actually taking my stuff out the house. So hard for me to actually see that happen, and they were saying, "Mummy, help us. These men are taking our stuff." I was saying to them, "You can take the washing machine, you can take that, but just can you leave the kids' stuff alone?" They wouldn't. Sorry. I hate going back there. I didn't want to live no more. How am I going to get out of this situation? And then I met this lovely lady called Esther. She was amazing, absolutely amazing. And I started telling her bits about my story of my life and stuff like that. And she said, "Oh, I can help you. This come through today." She goes, "I'm meant to help with your debts and there's not a cost. It's done by a charity." I was like, "What?" I was like, "No, that can't be true." So she goes, "Right, I'm gonna put your name forward." But it seemed like it just happened just like that. It happened in weeks. I was like, wow. And I had my first appointment, and Catherine, when she come in, she could see there was no lights in the sitting room, the curtains was closed. I had three bags of the Shop for Life bags and big bags. I had three of them full of letters that's not even been opened. And yeah, and Carol and Catherine said, "Don't worry, we're sorted for them." And then just before they was leaving, they said, "Can we pray with you?" I've never prayed before in my life, never. And the warmth that come off of them too when they was praying for me was unbelievable. The only thing I could do was curl up and cry, because I just felt like, wow, what has just happened to me? I just felt so warm, and I felt like how much they actually cared for me. They gave me all the options, they gave me everything, every inch of the way. They was just in contact with me. Catherine was in contact with me, telling me what was going on, everything. I was constantly with her. Like, she didn't leave me. She didn't leave my side, or did Carol. I've been debt-free now for about just over 6 years. And them 6 years has been the best. I've got to say the best time of my life, because I've got family, I've got friends, I've got all sorts of stuff now. And I've actually got a life. I'm walking my life with God, and yeah. Yeah, it's amazing.
Now those who were scattered went about preaching the word. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip, when they heard him and saw the signs that he did. For unclean spirits, crying out with a loud voice, came out of many who had them, and many who were paralyzed, or lame who were healed. So there was much joy in that city. But there was a man named Simon, who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is the power of God that is called great." And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip as he preached Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed, and after being baptized, he continued with Philip. And seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for he had not yet fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. When they laid their hands on them and they received the Holy Spirit. Now when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the money of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, so that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." But Peter said to him, "May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall, for bitterness and in the bond of iniquity." And Simon answered, "Pray for me to the Lord, that nothing or what you have said may come upon me." Now when they had testified and spoken the word of the Lord, they returned to Jerusalem, preaching the gospel to many villages of the Samaritans.
No one is higher.
Christ, the risen King, is calling us, is sending us to go.
Good morning, my name is Jon Herring, pastor of Grace Church Leatherhead, and a warm welcome to you for joining us. Thank you for tuning in this morning. We're continuing our series in Acts, and we're in chapter 8 this morning, verses 4 to 25, and I'm going to lead us in a prayer as we begin. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you that through your word we can grow to know and love you more deeply. We do pray that you would speak to every single one of us this morning by your Spirit. Encourage us, challenge us, reveal more of your love to us, we pray. And we pray that as we go away from here this morning, you would be using us, working in and through us by your Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Great. Well, as we start, I wonder whether we could consider how we feel about evangelism. It's a word that can bring a lot of us out in hot sweats, I think, can't it? It can be a bit of a scary word. And I think it causes lots of us to feel a mixture of emotions, from fear to guilt, maybe to embarrassment. But I wonder if that's because we concentrate too much on our fear of people and what they will think, and not enough on the power of Christ and the joy of knowing him. We make it too much about what people are like. We look at the people around us who don't know Jesus, our friends or family or work colleagues, and it seems impossible to imagine talking to them about Jesus, let alone seeing them change. We look at ourselves and we feel like we're not up to the job. We don't know enough, or we're not confident enough, or maybe we've made a mess of it before. Maybe we feel so guilted into it by our church leaders that we rebel against it. But what this passage teaches us today, it reminds us that Christ empowers his people in the most difficult of situations to proclaim him. And the result is complete joy and satisfaction in Christ for those who believe. I hope that we'll see this as we go in three ways. Christ is the one who sovereignly takes his gospel out. Christ is the one with the power to save anyone from anywhere. And Christ is the one in whom we find true joy, satisfaction, and transformation. Up to this point in the book of Acts, we've seen the power of the gospel as it's preached in Jerusalem. Many thousands of Jews have come to faith, despite the best efforts of those who want to stop it. But today we'll see something new happening, as the gospel begins to go out from Jerusalem in the most surprising of ways. At the beginning of the chapter, we see that the church is scattered through persecution. It's no longer safe for Christians to live in Jerusalem. Stephen has just been brutally murdered, and now a new sinister figure is on the scene. He was first introduced standing on the edges as Stephen is killed in verse 58 of chapter 7. A young man whose feet the witnesses laid their clothes at. A man who we're told approved of the execution of the spirit-filled man of God, Stephen, a man named Saul. He clearly belongs on the other side of that great divide we saw last week. He's one of those stiff-necked, uncircumcised people, outwardly religious, but inwardly opposed to God and his true people. Yet until the beginning of chapter 8, he's just watching in the background. But then suddenly, in verses 1 to 3, we see him stepping out of the shadows, and suddenly he is the most menacing threat of all. As the church reels from Stephen's murder and devout men bury him, Saul rises up, going from house to house, dragging off men and women to prison. He's described as ravaging the church. It's terrible and violent. And as a result of this great persecution, which Saul seems to be at the forefront of, the church is scattered. The picture is chaotic. It all looks completely out of control, and that the church is in a mess and God's plans once again seem to be being stopped. But is it? Because what we see in verse 4 is that once again, the exact opposite of what those who oppose God's people want is achieved, as this scattering ironically only advances God's work. Because Christ is the one who sovereignly takes his gospel out. Verse 4, those who were scattered went about preaching the word. As the people of God are scattered through persecution, it doesn't stop them from proclaiming Christ. As we read through Acts, we see a very clear priority and pattern emerge. The priority and pattern of gospel proclamation. God raises up people to boldly proclaim his good news, and people are saved. But it almost always comes at a cost. As the gospel goes out, the gospel is opposed, and persecution comes. But so often it's through this persecution that the gospel goes out even more. Well, in our passage today, we see that God has raised up another man to be his spokesman. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. Now, Samaria wouldn't have been a place that any of the disciples would have chosen to end up, because for hundreds of years there had been a long-standing hostility and division between the Samaritans and the Jews, due to the Samaritans intermarrying with Gentiles after the exile and thereby becoming defiled and unholy in the eyes of the Jews. Jews had completely cut them off and would avoid Samaria and Samaritans at all costs. But now, finding himself unexpectedly in Samaria, Philip sees an opportunity before him. He knows God's word is the power of God to save. He's seen it in Jerusalem. And what is startling is that he doesn't waste a minute debating whether it's a word for the Samaritans too. Even in a place like Samaria, he has confidence in God's power to save. And so he gets straight on with proclaiming Christ, the person in whom the fullness of the gospel, the good news of salvation is found, to a people who've not yet heard of him, a people who back in Jerusalem might not be considered worthy of Christ, but to a people who Philip clearly perceives he has strategically been placed amongst. Let's not lose how remarkable this response is from Philip. He's not just arrived here as a tourist on a nice holiday. He's fled here as a result of bitter persecution. Yet amazingly, rather than hiding himself away and hoping to avoid more of the same or complaining or losing confidence in what God's doing, he focuses entirely on Christ. He is completely devoted to his king and his kingdom work, wherever he finds himself and whatever the circumstances. I was chatting to a guy this week who I've gotten to know recently, who I can't tell you much about for his and others' safety, but he's just been kicked out of a country in the Gulf region where he helped establish a church. It's a country where it's illegal to convert to Christianity. But through the proclamation of the gospel, they have seen people come to faith and be converted. The church has to operate underground because conversions are illegal, and Christians face being arrested and cut off from society. Their families might never get a job again and would be treated as outcasts. Well, this is exactly what happened with one family in my friend's church. And when the authorities found out about my friend, who was one of the elders and leaders of the church, his visa was taken away and he was kicked out of the country immediately and permanently. But he told me of how the church he has left behind haven't stopped in their efforts. They continue to preach the gospel, in fact, with even more boldness and conviction. And rather than losing confidence in God's plan, he himself is now planning where in the Arab-speaking world he's going to go next to proclaim the gospel. And he told me about a couple of places that he's thinking about going that are some of the most dangerous places to go. Places where, humanly speaking, you wouldn't expect people to come to Christ. But he believes in God's power to save, and that God has gifted him with the ability to speak the Arab tongue. So he wants to go and make disciples there, despite the danger. Praise God that he continues to raise up people like this, willing to go wherever God would have them. And praise God for the many Christians who persevere in the underground church across the world, in places that may seem impossible or forgotten, but in God's plan are significant and strategic beyond what we can imagine. And we can all pray that God would give us a similar heart to be used wherever he places us and with whoever he puts us in front of us. Because as the passage continues, we see just how confident we can be in God's power. Christ is the one with the power to save anyone from anywhere. Amazingly, the crowds of Samaria, this forgotten, unholy place, are listening attentively, verse 6. And the crowds, with one accord, paid attention to what was being said by Philip. And his words, like Stephen's, are backed with mighty works that bring much joy in the city. People are being healed, not just spiritually, but physically through his ministry, to show the power of God. These signs support the fact that God is doing a great work here in Samaria, that place that many Jews had written off. And at this point, Luke focuses in on one particular convert, Simon. And what's clear is that Simon has a huge influence in this confused and ungodly place. Verse 9. There was a man named Simon who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was somebody great. They all paid attention to him, for from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is the power of God. That is called great." And they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with this magic. Through his practice of magic, Simon had made a name for himself, and he'd become something of a godlike figure. And it's clear that in Samaria, they paid attention to him because for a long time he had amazed them with his magic. But the message of the gospel, as we've seen, has power beyond any earthly power, and it is unstoppable. And so verse 12, despite the influence that Simon has, that he's had in this place for so many years, when the people of Samaria heard Philip, they believed as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. They were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed. And after being baptized, he continued with Philip. And seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. The magnitude of this moment is hard for us to grasp in our context. But this is a city which has a 1,000-year history of division and opposition towards God's people. And it's clearly under the influence of a man who appears to have godlike status. But Philip's message about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ leaves them amazed. And all of them, even Simon himself, follow Stephen to find out more. And it soon becomes known by the apostles, and they understand the importance of recognizing and affirming such a momentous event. And so Luke records this unique and potentially slightly confusing occasion. Peter and John came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit, for he had not fallen on any of them, but they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. This is a unique moment. Verse 16 shows us that this is not the norm. God doesn't normally hold back his Holy Spirit at conversion. The giving of the Holy Spirit is the mark that you are one of God's people. And so it's a gift that is given at conversion, as we see time and time again throughout the New Testament. But here we have a unique and special moment in the history of God's gospel as it begins to go out to the wider world, which is 21st century Christians living miles and miles away from Jerusalem, we could easily miss the significance of. And as a result, we find this event maybe a bit confusing. But as we've said, for the Samaritans to receive Christ and be brought in, united with God's people, equal with the Jews, well, this would have been shocking. And it called for God's clear confirmation that these people really did now belong to him. And so we see he holds back the giving of his Holy Spirit until the apostles, the ones who've been divinely appointed with an authority in establishing the church, to come and lay hands on them. And as they do, the Spirit is poured out. It's a sign that God's kingdom really has come here in Samaria. Work uniting the strongest of divisions, breaking down walls of hostility, and calling his people from every nation. Some people abuse this passage. They try to use it to suggest that there's a second blessing needed for you to become a real sort of second tier true Christian. You see this a lot in Pentecostal churches. They use this passage to preach the idea that there is a second blessing that's needed, where you receive the fullness of the Holy Spirit, which you need to be a real Christian. And you could see how, if you took these verses out and read them in isolation, out of context, that you might interpret it that way. But a two-stage initiation actually teaches the opposite of what this passage is trying to teach us. This moment is showing how God's kingdom is for all who receive Christ. It's a uniting moment. He's showing that there are now no no-go zones for the gospel. Anyone is welcome into God's kingdom, wherever they're from, however far away and violently against God they seem to be. The power of God cannot be stopped. He can transform and change the hardest of hearts. As these Samaritans repent of their old pagan ways and believe the gospel, they now receive the Spirit in the full view of the apostles. It's proof that they too belong fully in the people of God. That's what this is all about. The gospel is not going to be contained in Jerusalem, but just as Jesus said and Luke records at the beginning of the book of Acts, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." God's plan is on the march. So as we read this in our times, it raises questions for us. Are there people and places that you find yourself thinking that the gospel couldn't reach? As you see your friends and colleagues wrapped up in worldly pleasures, living life however they please, not giving God a second thought, we might find ourselves thinking, I could never share the gospel with them. They'd laugh at me and mock me and send me packing. Maybe you think of your friends brought up in other faiths and how it's so culturally ingrained in them that they could never possibly turn to Christ. Or maybe it's your friend who is that adamant atheist who, whenever you talk about Jesus, just shuts you down and doesn't let you speak. Well, these historic events that Luke records here for us should give us great confidence that God can break into any heart, any community, and transform them. After all, he's broken into mine and into yours if you're trusting in Christ. So, will you trust that God has put you where he has for a purpose? Maybe you feel you'd be better suited somewhere else. Maybe the circumstances that have brought you to where you are in your life feel unwelcome. But as we've seen, even in the most chaotic and confusing of moments, God is entirely strategic. He knows exactly where he's placed you and why. What would it look like for you to proclaim Christ where you are? What is it going to look like for us as a church community when we're able to meet together again to proclaim the gospel to the lost? And what about proclaiming the gospel in such a time as this? I guess for lots of us, the only means at our disposal is online right now. One of the reasons Ruth and I have stayed on social media is for the opportunity it brings to share the gospel. The world of social media can be a chaotic and confusing place, and even with the best of convictions, it's so easy to get distracted from that. And of course, it's nice to share other things too. Christians need to be real and human. But if you're engaging on social media and you have any kind of voice there, consider that part of God's strategic plan for you. Because if you have a voice there, you have an opportunity to proclaim Christ. As your friends scroll through Facebook feeds, would they know you're a Christian? Do your words express the hope you have? Do they contrast with the fear and gloom of the world around us? If you go online simply to switch off and mindlessly scroll through social media platforms, then maybe you might just as well come off it. But if you go online thinking, how might I be used here for Christ's glory? How might he strategically use me? Then you can expect that he will. Let's not miss the opportunity of this moment in history right now, whether it's online or through whatever other connections God has given us, however random they might seem. Let's be bold in the knowledge that behind every detail of our lives, God sovereignly moves to bring about his purposes. I've already talked a little bit about the idea of doing a Christianity Explore course online for anyone seeking to know more, but that will mean as a church that we will need to be bold to invite friends and to get involved. So as we think about all this, we need to be convinced that Christ is the one who sovereignly takes his gospel out. Christ is the one with the power to save anyone from anywhere. Well, Luke has shown us that God is reigning over the events of history as we see the gospel going out, even through great persecution, and that he is strategically placing people where he wants to as part of that. We've seen a man, Philip, fully convinced of that truth and fully devoted to Christ, fully submitting to being used by him wherever he's placed. But now, Simon comes back into the frame, and we see an attitude that stands entirely in contrast to Philip's. Now, when Simon saw that the Spirit was given through the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money, saying, "Give me this power also, so that anyone on whom I lay my hands may receive the Holy Spirit." In the past, Simon has gained influence and power through doing miraculous things and performing magic. And so as he sees the unique role that the apostles have and sees them laying hands on people to give the Holy Spirit, he wants some of that. He sees a new opportunity for personal power and individual influence, such as he had in his old life. And he thinks he can have it again as a Christian. And so he seeks to achieve this the only way that he knows how, through his money. Again, this is something that is seen time and time again in the church, where the ways of the world begin to pervade the church. Sadly, many church leaders have risen up who have shockingly used their role for personal gain and influential power. And churches have sought to influence people through promises of supernatural personal experience and the promise of health and wealth if they become Christians, or that you can buy favour with God. And this is so dangerous. It's not the gospel. Remember, Philip's primary focus was to proclaim the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ. And we've seen this heart in all the men and women God has raised up throughout Acts so far and used for his purposes. Because they understand not only is Christ the one who sovereignly takes his gospel out, and that Christ is the one with the power to save anyone from anywhere, but also Christ is the one in whom we find true joy, satisfaction, and transformation. The people Jesus sends out for his kingdom work are clearly not out for selfish gain and personal ambition. Quite the opposite. They have been prepared to preach the gospel in the face of extreme persecution, in the face of violent threat to their own lives. Philip has been our example of this attitude this week. On the one hand, it seems that he is a man who has lost everything, even the chance to choose where he lives and who he ministers to. Yet, just like we saw with Stephen last week, we see he has not really lost anything at all. We don't know much about Philip's backstory or what he's lost as he is cast out of his hometown. But what we do see is a man utterly devoted to Christ and utterly submitted to his plan. He is willing to be used for his glory wherever he's placed, because he has found such joy and satisfaction in him. And clearly this joy is infectious, because we see that in verse 8, that his ministry produces much joy in that city. Submitting to Christ and delighting in him has not only brought Philip a joy that makes him willing to risk his life again, but it has caused that joy to flow out to the Samaritans, that forgotten people written off by most. They have found Christ too. Philip has lost it all in worldly terms, willingly. But in reality, he has gained the only thing worth really having, Christ. But now, here we have Simon foolishly trying to hold on to power, holding on to influence and worldly pleasure. And in doing so, he risks it all. And so Peter rebukes him. May your silver perish with you, because you thought you could obtain the gift of God with money. You have neither part nor lot in this matter, for your heart is not right before God. Repent, therefore, of this wickedness of yours, and pray to the Lord that, if possible, the intent of your heart may be forgiven you. For I see that you are in the gall of bitterness and in the bond of iniquity. Peter is clear that Simon's desire suggests his heart is still in danger of being enslaved to his former way of life. Simon wants it all. He wants in on Christ's kingdom while still wanting to rule his own little mini kingdom. Simon wants the power that comes from Christ, yet he wants to manipulate it for his own purposes. But this is not the way of those who truly belong to Christ, who live wholeheartedly for God. So Peter sets him straight. You can't serve Christ and yourself. You can't desire Christ and lust after worldly riches. You can't want Christ's glory and your own. Martin Luther says this: I have held many things in my hands and have lost them all, but whatever I have placed in God's hands, that I still possess. This is the truth Peter seeks to challenge and encourage Simon with, as he warns him starkly of the danger he's in and calls him to repent. Because despite Simon's wickedness, he is still not without hope. The name of Christ offers forgiveness even now for this. And Simon's response shows a turning point in his understanding, as he says, pray for me to the Lord that nothing of what you have said may come upon me. What a transformation. A transformation that can only come through the words and work of the Holy Spirit. He's humbled, not just to turn to Christ, but to realise that he needs help even in doing that. A man who has known real power and influence is slowly beginning to submit to God's rule in his life, it seems. Yet he needed Peter to reveal this to him. He needed Peter to continue to preach the gospel of forgiveness and repentance and faith to him. Because the good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ is the power for ongoing discipleship and transformation. Here we have an example of the need to continue to proclaim the gospel, to keep speaking the truth about Jesus' death and resurrection, to help those who God is truly calling not to be distracted and enticed by the things of the world. And those of us who have been Christians for years need to keep hearing it too. The work of proclaiming Christ doesn't stop at conversion. Making disciples isn't just about that initial evangelism and people praying a prayer and calling themselves Christians. Discipleship is an ongoing process where we continue to proclaim the gospel to each other and we all mature in faith. That's why we need a church community that encourages each other, not just on a Sunday, but throughout the week and throughout our life. A community that is real and honest about our struggles and doubts, where we know each other intimately and feel able to confess our sins and can pray for each other and point each other to Christ. A community sometimes prepared to say the hard things to one another, to warn one another when we see someone taking a path away from Christ. Because, once again, we have seen that it is only in him that true joy is found. To reject Christ is unthinkable. So as we close, let's pray that we would be convinced that Christ is the one who sovereignly takes his gospel out, that Christ is the one with the power to save anyone from anywhere. And would we be reminded that Christ is the one in whom we find true joy, satisfaction, and transformation? And let's devote our hearts and submit our lives to him again. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for the reminder of the power of Christ and his gospel. Lord, we pray that we would be those who confidently proclaim your gospel because we know the power of the gospel to save. Lord, would we know that you have placed us where you have placed us for this very purpose? And would you give us a boldness to speak of you as we are reminded of your power and as we are reminded of the joy that that brings to those who put their trust in you? Lord, help us to continue to proclaim it to each other, that we would continue to mature in faith and encourage and challenge each other, that we might finish the race, that we might be called good and faithful servant on that last day. Lord, please be at work in and through us by your Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray. All right, here we go. Come say your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. Are your church, and we need your power. All right, let's go. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst. Refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. Darkness fear, show your mind. let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and our land. Set your church on fire in this nation, but change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here. We pray. We're praying for revival. All right.
Let's pray. Lord God, we come before you this morning as a people who want to be those that proclaim Christ to the city and area that we find ourselves in. Lord, we know that it is only through the proclamation of Christ that mankind can enjoy salvation. Salvation from the very condition that man finds itself in. Salvation from the sin that easily ensnares us. Salvation from death being ultimate in this world. Lord, we know that much joy can be brought through this salvation, and we ask, Lord, that we wouldn't hide the truth, but we would boldly proclaim that truth to those that you bring us into contact with in our daily lives, our neighbours, our friends and family, our work colleagues, and those that we know from school, college and university. Lord, may we be bold in the work of proclaiming Christ that you have given us as Christians to carry out. Lord, guard us from thinking that this endeavour is something that we can do in our own strength, or something that can be bought with effort or money or time or resources. Salvation is of you, Lord, and we are simply your chosen vessels for bringing that truth to this world. Lord, we ask that in your strength we might be worthy vessels of that message. We ask that we wouldn't grieve the Holy Spirit, and that we might keep short accounts with you, confessing our sin and walking closely with our God. Lord, even when we are saved, we are continuing in our need of your salvation daily. Help us as we grow in our knowledge of you to be more Christ-like in the lives that we lead. As a church, may we always be moving closer to Christ. And we ask, Lord, that the world around us would be aware of these things, that they would notice that we are different. Protect us, Lord, from lives that aren't distinctive. May we be a sweet aroma rising up to you. May we be those who honour you as we preach the gospel to those around us. We glory, Lord, in the fact that this isn't the only church that is virtually meeting together in your name today. All over the UK and indeed across the world, there are groups of Christians meeting at churches and living out your commands to make disciples of all the nations. Lord, we pray that we would be those that take part in these activities of gospel proclamation. Lord, we want to pray this morning for anyone in the church who hasn't been well this week. We ask that they would know your healing even today, Lord, and that they might soon be restored to health. Lord, we pray for Maureen and ask that you would continue to heal her as she gets over a virus. Lord, we praise you that you've protected her from COVID at this time, and that we pray that you would continue to do so. Lord, we bring Brian before you this morning and ask that you would bring him comfort. May his faith be in you and your sovereign power over all situations. Thank you for your continued protection of Caroline Pugh, and we ask that you would continue to bless her as she recovers from her treatment. We've been thinking this morning about the work of Christians Against Poverty, and we ask that you would continue to bless the work of this organisation. We pray particularly for Richard and ask, Lord, that you would prosper the work that he does for CAP. We ask that even now, Lord, you would be preparing the hearts of new clients who may be helped by CAP's debt relief advice, but ultimately that they might be helped by your salvation, not from the debt of this world, but that they might be saved from the debt of sin in their own lives. Praise God that Christ has wiped clean our debts and is able to present us faultless before a holy God. We pray, Lord, for any who are feeling lonely, particularly at this time of lockdown, and we ask, Lord, that they might find solace in the Bible and that they might acknowledge you as they feast on Scripture. Lord, be close to them at this time and reveal yourself to those that seek you. Lord, we ask that you would bless Boris Johnson and Keir Starmer as they lead their parties, and we pray for the government as they seek to navigate our country through these difficult times. Lord, grant them wisdom in the decisions that they have to make, particularly on the pandemic, and give them clarity of mind and an understanding of the right decisions to make. Lord, we ask that all those that you have put in power over us would be blessed by you, that you would grant them long life, prosperity and success in their endeavours. Lord, bless this congregation, scattered wide and meeting virtually. Bless us as we conclude our time of virtual worship this morning. And may we be those who apply what we've heard to our own lives. May we be those who live lives that are worthy. Help us to confess our sins and to not be weighed down by them as we proclaim Christ to a watching world around us. We ask all this in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
You take what is and you make it beautiful. When love floods in, we restored forevermore. With breath that brings the dead to life, with words that pierce the dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. All with mercy strong to carry shame and nailed it to a tree. You alone, all the power to redeem. No guilt competes with innocence crucified. Oh, no grave can hold what your grace has justified. With breath that brings the dead to life, with words that pierce the dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. All with mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree. You alone, all the power to redeem. Rejoice, O child of God. Oh, lift your eyes to see. With every morning light, again we are redeemed. With breath that brings the dead to life, words that pierce the dark with light, only by the blood are we set free. All with mercy strong to carry shame and nail it to a tree. You alone, all the power to redeem. Oh, you alone, all the power to redeem. Oh, you alone, all the power to redeem.
Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on fire, win this nation back. Change the atmosphere, build your kingdom here, we pray. All right, here we go. Come say your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now.